Are you a large company looking to go carbon neutral but don't want to change your core behaviour or the amount of emissions you put into the atmosphere? Well, we'll make it as easy as 1, 2, net zero. Let's tell you how. Junk offsets. Come down to Jay's Offset Emporium and we'll get you whatever you need as cheaply as possible and get you to carbon neutral as quick as you can say greenwashing. Let's get started.
I'm Jay Lipman, this is The Day Before Tomorrow, and today, junk carbon offsets. We are going to explore how to determine the quality of an offset, explain just what a junk offset is, and answer the question, can offsets still be used as an effective tool to fight climate change? We should just let them know off the bat that the answer is yes.
We can go.
We'll come.
Right up top.
We'll come back to it, yes. Before we get started, I want to say that this video is about good offsets versus bad offsets, but we will be putting out an episode about the validity of offsets and the need to use them in conjunction with cutting emissions in the future. And in that video, I'll be rocking 80s workout gear, and I hope you enjoy it as much as I do. So, what is a junk offset? I am so glad you asked. Let's get started by explaining what it is not. A functional offset is a relatively simple concept. A company, government, or individual emits carbon into the atmosphere and purchases a credit in the form of entities that reduce or remove that same amount of carbon with the goal of arriving at net zero emissions. Let's think of the planet like a bathtub, one that is currently a little bit warmer than we might like. Carbon emissions are the water. Right, some companies shoot more out of the tap than others, and if they're not careful, they'll overflow the tub. Now, the planet has always had a carbon cycle, which historically lived in equilibrium. This was the amount of carbon coming into the atmosphere equal to the amount of carbon coming out, because before industrialization, those things were in balance. But since industrialization, we have had more carbon coming into the atmosphere than is able to escape. And that is what brings us to the bathtub. You see, we now have more water coming into the atmospheric bathtub than we have the ability to remove. And what removes it are drains. And by drain, I mean carbon sinks, right? Things like peatland, rainforests, and seagrasses, natural sequesterers of that carbon. But again, industrialization has resulted in more and more water being pumped into our big, beautiful bathtub faster than it is able to drain out. So we need to A, slow down the tap, right, cut emissions, and B, create more drains to remove that additional carbon. That's where carbon offsets theoretically come in. But junk offsets are like a drain that we're told works, but is, forgive me, right, actually clogged with, use your imagination, maybe the lost souls of rubber ducks, as well as other bodily things. Just as the contents of everyone's shower drain vary, so do, in fact, carbon offsets. But how do we determine if an offset is junk or quality? Let's look at three definitions that will help us understand that. First up, we have additionality, the foundation of every quality offset. Now, for an offset to be effective, it has to provide an extra reduction of carbon that wouldn't have otherwise happened. For junk offsets, this additionality or lack thereof is where many of these projects fall short, because it can't be proven or simply just doesn't exist. For example, an offset protecting, say, the trees in Central Park doesn't do much because those trees aren't actually at risk of being logged. There just aren't that many lumberjacks wandering down Fifth Avenue. Except for me.
Did you cut down a tree in Central Park? It's a felony.
We don't talk about it. Next up, we have co-benefits. No, this is not everyone's favorite sequel to the classic Mila Kunis film, but something even more beguiling. Simply put, co-benefits are the indirect impacts of offset projects on anything that's not carbon emissions. This can be things like nature preservation, water quality, or economic benefits for local communities. We believe strong offset programs are structured to maximize those co-benefits, while weak ones are not mindful of or disregard those co-benefits entirely. Finally, corresponding adjustment. As exciting as it sounds, and an official term for a sweet move that we call the double dip. Essentially, when carbon credits are transferred from one entity to another and are claimed by both parties involved in that transaction. That would be like me giving you this teapot, but then telling everyone that we both have this beautiful blue little teapot. See, I'd get to be the cool kid at the club bragging about my teapot, but I couldn't actually make anyone any tea because you'd have the teapot.
No one's gonna take your teapot.
It's safe. So we've covered the building blocks that determine if an offset is effective or just junk, but what's the takeaway here? As I said, we will continue to explore the role of offsets in the fight against climate change, but the bottom line today is that if an offset is junk, it's not only ineffective, it can be a harmful device that allows companies to get away with producing even more emissions. At the end of the day, this comes down to the fact that junk offsets are typically cheap offsets, and when it's cheaper to buy a junk offset than to change your behavior, cut emissions, or buy quality offsets, then that's what companies, governments, or other entities will probably do. To end with our beloved bathtub metaphor, a drain is a necessary and effective tool in keeping our big, beautiful tub from overflowing. But when clogged with cheap, isolated, ineffective gunk, a drain is just a plug. And if we don't get ourselves a working drain, this tub is just gonna keep overflowing. I'm Jay Lipman, this is The Day Before Tomorrow, and stay the hell away from my teapot.
Jay, no one wants the teapot.
Everyone wants the teapot. Everyone wants it.